Hello friends, Smart Readers welcomes you all. These are the toughest times and you are probably experiencing inability to reach us. Don't worry, we Smart Readers will reach out to you all. To assist the UPSC aspirants in their prelims revision ahead of the examination, we came up with the online current affairs video series. In the first video, we will begin with the science and technology current affairs for the month of July 2019. The first topic is barcoding of medicines sold locally in India. We are all would have been already familiar with what is called as barcodes. And a barcode is a machine readable code which are in the form of numbers and parallel lines of varying widths and thickness. And this barcode are particularly used for identifying a particular product since its manufacturing till its sales. In general, the barcodes are of two types: linear barcodes or one dimensional, and the second type is two dimensional barcodes. Two dimensional barcodes is also called as QR codes, quick response codes. And to add point, a quick response code can be used to encode over 4000 characters in it. In addition to this, a QR code can also be used to display a text to the user, to open an URL, or even to save a contact to the address book. The barcoding of medicines is fairly a good practice followed in the Western countries already. In India, it is only voluntary so far. In 2019, Special 301 report. The Special 301 report is published by the Office of the United States Trade Representatives in an annual manner. And this report felt a wrong light on the existence of counterfeit drugs in India. So in response to that, the government decided to make barcoding mandatory. Earlier, it was only voluntary. Now it is mandatory on all medicines sold locally. So what are the two reasons for this move? One, to offset the India's infamous reputation as a source of counterfeit drugs. And second, it will also help in ascertaining the authenticity of medicines, ability to monitor their availability, its expiration, checking, and also to track and trace the recalls whenever and wherever needed. The second topic, let us discuss about Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee and the related issues. Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee, formerly called as Genetic Engineering Approval Committee, is a statutory body functioning under Ministry of Environment and Forest and Climate Change. And this GEAC is established under Rules 1989 under Environmental Protection Act 1986. The three main functions of GEAC are: 1. To appraise activities involving large scale use of hazardous microorganisms and genetically engineered microorganisms in research and industrial production from the environmental perspective. The second function is to appraise proposals relating to the release of genetically modified organisms into the environment, which includes field trials. Third function, the committee also has the power of punitive actions, which can be taken by itself or it can delegate it to an authorized person under the Environmental Protection Act 1986. In India, the first genetically engineered crop to be approved was BT cotton. And it is also the only approved genetically engineered crop as of now in India. It was approved in the year 2002. And since then, it has undergone various developments and improvements. The first generation BT cotton contains Cry-A1B gene derived from the bacteria Bacillus thuringiensis. That's why it is called as BT cotton. And the second generation BT cotton contains Cry-1BC gene, also from the same BT bacteria. The first and the second generation provides resistance against pink bollworm pest, whereas the third generation is quite different. The third generation BT cotton contains the gene CP4 abscess gene derived from the bacteria Agrobacterium tumefaciens. And this third generation BT cotton will be resistant against glyphosate. Glyphosate is a broad spectrum herbicide that can kill broadleaf plants and grasses as well. And farmers cannot use this glyphosate on normal cotton because the glyphosate cannot distinguish between the crop and the weed, and thereby the resistance for the crop is required. And to enable this function, the third generation BT cotton was developed. In 2012, a Supreme Court appointed technical expert committee gone through the issue of genetically engineered crops in agricultural usage and came up with the findings that it is considered to be deleterious to the interest of the farmers and thus imposed an indefinite moratorium on the genetically engineered crops. And since then, no genetically engineered crops are approved so far in India. And this has created a frustration among the farmers because they cannot reap the benefits of the science and developments. And while the damage from the pests are continuing. So in a response of showing the frustration, a group of farmers led by Shetkari Sangathana, a farmers organization, have conducted the field sowing of unapproved transgenic cotton and brinjal in the Akola district of Maharashtra. And both transgenic cotton and the BT brinjal has the characteristics of resistance against glyphosate. And according to the farmers, this was considered as a civil disobedience movement to protest the central government's indecisiveness in approving the next generation of GM crops. We are all familiar with the genetic engineering of crops and organisms, where the DNA of one organism is cut and placed into the genome of another organism. This is an engineering process, whereas this can happen naturally also. And when it happens, we call it as transposons. What are transposons? Transposons are also colloquially called as jumping genes. And transposons are DNA sequences that can cut itself from one location of the genome and integrate into the other part of the genome. And I would like to emphasize, it doesn't happen between one organism and the other organism. It happens within the same organism. Transposons cut from one location and paste it into another location. Even though we call transposons as genes, it does not code for any proteins. Transposons does not code for any proteins. And transposons is one of the most familiar part of any genome. It is found in all organisms from prokaryotes such as bacteria to eukaryotes such as humans. To give an example for this, about 50% of the human genome is consisting of transposons. But what are their relevance and importance? Because they can cut from one part and move to another area, they can potentially cause mutations which can also result in cancers. The second importance, the movement of the genes within the genome is a driver for the evolution. So transposons are also considered as drivers of evolutionary processes. And third, in this process of moving back and forth, it can also enable the regulation of certain genes. It also acts as gene regulators. Now, why there is a renewed interest about the transposons? We all would have been familiar with what is called as CRISPR-Cas9. So CRISPR-Cas9 is a newbie which finds its much relevance and usage in the genetic engineering experiments because of its easiness and less skill required and also its cheapness. And in addition to that, scientists have found out that transposons also can be used as an agent of genetic engineering. So they found out that these transposons can be integrated with the guide DNA sequences that can be used to precisely integrate the genes of interest into any genome. And these transposons have the ability to deliver up to 10,000 bases long DNA sequences, which is why it was in the news. Antibiotic resistance. is the biggest problem that the doctor face nowadays in treating patients. And in this context, what are superbugs? Superbugs are microorganisms that can cause diseases and also becoming resistant to the most commonly used antibiotics, usually more than two antibiotics. Very often, the term superbug refers to bacteria, but it can also be a reference to fungi also. The three main reasons why superbug emerges: the one, overuse, abuse of antibiotics, such as in the livestock sector. Second, lack of discipline in the treatment regimen of a patient. And third, it can also emerge as a natural evolutionary processes in the microorganisms. Why it was on the news? Researchers at the University of Southern California have found out that there is a new method of how superbugs get transmitted to the humans. Earlier, it was known that it can transmit it from human to humans in hospital conditions. It was known. The second, it can also be known to be transmitted through environmental mode, where one superbug will pass on their character to another normal bacteria that becomes superbug. It's called as environmental mode of dissemination. That is also known. But the third, scientists found out that superbugs can be transmitted even from plants. And this contamination of the plants on its surface is considered to be the prime mode of superbugs entering the humans, which is why it was on the news. The next topic is about a new herbal drug called as leucosil. And this leucosil has been developed to treat leucoderma. Leucoderma, it is a skin disease which are characterized by white patches on the surface. And this appearance of white patches on the skin is due to the depigmentation of the skin caused by the destruction of melanocytes in the body. And this can happen due to thermal burns, genetics, or even autoimmune disorders. And to treat this, leucosin was developed as a herbal product by Defense Institute of Bioenergy Research, which is a unit of DRDO. And this leucosin skin dual therapy comes in oral liquid and ointment formulations, which are known to be a magic drug for treating leucoderma. The next topic is about a unique discovery about the moon. Gravity Recovery and Interior Laboratory, GRAIL mission also called this, have detected an anomaly in the moon's gravitational field, Where this anomaly was detected? This anomaly was found in the South Pole Arcane Basin, SPA Basin also. And this anomaly, why it occurred? It was discovered that a metal-rich asteroid has impacted this SPA Basin and stuck with the mantle layer of the moon rather than sinking into the core of the moon. Because it got stuck with the mantle, there have been mass imbalances in the moon, and the mass imbalances have caused gravitational fluctuations. And this discovery was made by GRAIL. The GRAIL is a part of NASA's Discovery program launched in 2011, and it lasted for 1 year because it was decommissioned in the year 2012. And GRAIL involves two spacecrafts, GRAIL A and GRAIL B, also called as Ebb and Flow. And the main mission of the GRAIL is to study and create the most accurate gravitational map of the moon to date. The next topic is about Spectrum Röntgen Gamma Telescope. Before we move into the topic, let us say a few words about X-ray astronomy. X-ray is a part of the electromagnetic spectrum with the energy ranging from about 1 kilo electron volt to about 100 kilo electron volts. And there are two types of X-rays based on the energy. An X-ray that has an energy more than 10 kilo electron volt are called as hard X-ray, and the energy less than 10 kilo electron volt is called as soft X-ray. And this X-ray based astronomy is a valuable insight. It gives valuable insight to the astronomers with respect to studying about the black holes, supernova explosions, and quasars and pulsars. And it is in the utility of the X-ray astronomy that Germany and Russia have collaborated together for a joint project, and this joint project is called as Spectrum Röntgen Gamma Telescope. And this Spectrum Long and Gamma telescope was launched by Proton M rocket of Russia, and it is right now in the orbit. It is right now in the Sun-Earth Lagrangian 2 orbit of about 1.5 million kilometers away from the Earth. And the main mission objectives of the Spectrum Long and Gamma telescope is it can detect up to 3 million supermassive black holes from the Milky Way. It can also create three-dimensional X-ray map of the universe, which in turn will help in unveiling the unknown supermassive black holes, dark energy, and other stars. It is a four-year mission with two payloads. The one payload is called as E-Rosetta, and the second payload is called as ArcXE. E-Rosetta will study soft X-ray astronomy, and ArcXE will study hard X-ray astronomy. And this four-year mission will survey the entire sky 8 times every day, and they track the evolution of the universe and the dark energy. And this is considered to be the first telescope which is sensitive to study the sky in hard X-ray spectrum. The next topic is about Giant Meter Wave Radio Telescope. Giant Meter Wave Radio Telescope is located in Pune, established and operated by National Center for Radio Astrophysics. And GMRT, Giant Meter Wave Radio Telescope, it consists of 30 fully steerable gigantic parabolic dishes that extends up to 25 kilometer land. And each of the dish is about 45 meter in diameter. Why there is a special interest on the meter wave radio astronomy? The reason is because of unique conditions that are existing in India. The meter wave spectrum of radio waves experiences a very less interference, radio interference in India. And because of this very low interference and the background noise, this particular spectrum was chosen for this radio telescope. It is a completely indigenous project based on SMART concept. It stands for stretch mesh attached to rope trusses. The two main objectives of Giant Meter Wave Radio Telescope. The first one, to study and detect the redshift spectral line of neutral hydrogen expected from the protoclusters. Protoclusters are evolutionary star systems that are known to have the high redshift phenomenon. The second objective is to study the rapidly rotating pulsars in the Milky Way. And Giant Meter Wave Telescope have recently contributed two important discoveries. The first one, it is involved in the discovery of the most distant galaxy ever at a distance of about 12 billion light years. The second contribution, in February 2020, it helped in the observation of the biggest explosion in the universe, called as Ophiuchus supercluster explosion. The next topic is about the new cryptocurrency Libra to be released by Facebook in the year 2020. Cryptocurrency. It is an internet-based medium of exchange that uses cryptographical functions to conduct financial transactions. And cryptocurrencies takes leverage of blockchain technology to gain decentralization, transparency, and immutability. There are various types of cryptocurrencies existing, like Bitcoin, Litecoin, Namecoin, Ethereum, etc. The existing cryptocurrencies such as Bitcoin or Ethereum are not properly engineered to be scaled to a medium of exchange because their unanchored price, I mean to say their price, is susceptible to huge and unpredictable swings that makes it tough for merchants to accept them as a payment. And recognizing this inherent problem of the cryptocurrencies, Facebook came up with the idea of Libra. And the mission of the cryptocurrency Libra is to enable a simple global financial currency and and as a medium of exchange for financial infrastructure to empower billions of people. And the word libra is a Roman unit of weight of measure. And it also evokes a sense of financial freedom by using the French stem word lib, which means freedom, liberty, which means freedom. And a libra unit is represented by a signal which is something similar like a waves. And using this libra, it can be used to send or receive money and also to buy things at nearly zero fees. And to manage this cryptocurrency libra, Facebook will launch a new company called a subsidiary company called Scalibra that will handle all the dealings of the cryptocurrency libra. The next topic is about the establishment of a new organization for the management of the pan-India air traffic in India. And this organization is called as Central Command Center for Air Traffic Flow Management System. And this is established in New Delhi. And the main objective of this agency is to balance capacity against the demand to achieve the optimum utilization of airport, airspace, and aircraft. And this centralized command center will process demand and capacity information along with static information about airports, airspaces, and air routes. And it helps to provide decision-making tools to the air traffic managers for collaborative decision-making and also to ensure regulated flow of traffic at each airport in India. And this agency integrates flight data from various subsystems like air traffic control automation systems, flight updates, flight update messages to provide a safe and orderly flow of traffic. And this system has enabled both offline and online interconnectivity of all the existing airports in India also. And the significance of this agency is two. The first significance is it can help in cutting down the flight delays by the balanced management of the traffic demand. And second, it helps as a solution for the space crunch that are available in the airports. The next topic is about a new technology to be adopted by the Indian Railways. And this technology is called as Trinetra technology. Trinetra refers to three different technologies here. And Trinetra is an abbreviation that stands for Terrain Imaging for Drivers, Infrared Enhanced, Optical and Radar Assisted Technology. And the main intention of this technology is to detect obstructions on the tracks and thus helping to prevent the accidents. Indian Railways, as we all know, is one of the world's largest railway network, comprising of about 115,000 kilometers. And it has also been very now and then that accidents in the tracks are often been witnessed in the Indian railway networks. And to avoid the dangers in the train tracks, that the Trinetra technology was developed. And this problem is most aggravated during the foggy conditions of Indian winter conditions. So, what are the components of the Trinetra technology? The Trinetra technology comprises two high-resolution optical cameras, a high-sensitivity infrared video camera, and also a radar-based terrain mapping system. And these three systems will work together. And it will combine the images captured and it will create a composite video image that will be displayed in front of the loco pilot on a computer monitor. And this system will thus help in enhancing the vision of the locomotive drivers in difficult weather conditions such as fog, heavy rains, night times, so that they have enough time to apply brakes without hitting the objects or obstructions. The next topic is about fuel cell technology. The fuel cell are electrochemical devices that uses the chemical energy of hydrogen or some other fuel along with the relevant catalysts that convert the energy directly into electricity and heat. A fuel cell is usually made up of three components: anode and cathode, the proton exchange membrane, also called as electrolytes, and catalyst. The fuel, when it is present at the anode along with the catalyst, it helps in the splitting up of hydrogen ions and the electrons. The hydrogen ions flows through the proton exchange membrane towards the cathode, and the electron moves through a circuit constituting current. And the hydrogen combines with the oxygen at the cathode, forming very pure water. So fuel cell is a clean source of energy that does not involve in any form of emissions at all. Normally, the catalysts that are used in the fuel cell plays a crucial role on how the fuel cell works. Very often, the catalysts that are used are expensive elements like platinum. These expensive elements, in fact, are known to degrade over a few cycles, and there is also a degradation of the performance over a period of time. So in the way that how fuel cell is being operationalized, the role of the catalyst is one of the important limitation factors. Now this explains the different types of fuel cells. We are mostly familiar with the proton exchange membrane, where hydrogen serves at the anode and oxygen at the cathode. But there are other types also, such as alkaline fuel cell, that uses hydrogen and oxygen at the cathode and the anode, but the electrolyte is sodium hydroxide. So it is called as alkaline fuel type. And similarly, there are called as direct methanol fuel type fuel cell, phosphoric acid fuel cell, molten carbonate fuel cell, and solid oxide fuel cell. But one point you can easily understand is, in all the types of fuel cells, except direct methanol, in all the types of fuel cells, anode and the cathode are served by hydrogen and oxygen only. Only in direct methanol type, that methanol solution in water serves as the anode. So the name of the fuel cell is defined by the electrolyte used. That is what that we need to take up from this. So proton exchange membrane, the electrolyte is a polymer membrane. In molten carbonate, the electrolyte is alkali carbonate. So that's an easy way to remember the different types of fuel cells are named based on the electrolyte used, except direct methanol. As we have discussed earlier, that the catalyst plays a very important role in the efficiency and the performance of the fuel cells. Platinum is usually costlier and it also degrades very quickly. And to solve this problem, a multi-institutional team of scientists from India, they developed a new form of a catalyst called a selenium graphene to be used in fuel cells, proton exchange membrane fuel cells. And they have found out that this selenium graphene based catalyst will work also with methanol type of direct methanol fuel cells also. And it was found to be stable for a very longer time compared with relatively with the platinum based catalysts. The next topic is about hypersonic technology demonstrator vehicle. Let's say first what an hypersonic is. An object that can travel more than 5 times the speed of sound is called as hypersonic. 5 times the speed of sound, it is also usually called as 5 Mach. An object that travels more than 5 Mach is called as hypersonic. So this hypersonic technology demonstrator vehicle is an indigenous project of DRDO, and it serves dual purpose. We'll discuss about this later. And this hypersonic technology demonstrator vehicle is to assess the performance of a scramjet engine at an altitude of about 15 to 20 kilometers at the atmosphere. And let us see a few words about scramjet technology. So scramjet technology is a type of air breathing propulsion technology that uses hydrogen as the fuel and takes oxygen directly from the atmosphere for the combustion. And in a scramjet technology, the combustion of the fuel takes place in the chamber at a supersonic speeds. The other form of air breathing technology is called as ramjet technology. And in the ramjet technology, the system collects the air from the atmosphere at subsonic speeds. So the difference between the scramjet and the ramjet is two. One, in scramjet, the combustion of the fuel takes place at a supersonic speeds, and in ramjet, the combustion of the fuel takes place at a subsonic speeds. Next, the air breathing propulsion technology, because it takes oxygen directly from the atmosphere, it cannot lift off its own. So any air breathing technology like a ramjet or scramjet, it requires an assistor to take off. And that is also true with this hypersonic technology demonstrator vehicle. So this HTDV was launched as an assisted takeoff from Agni 1 missile. So this demonstration project is an unmanned project that traveled at the speed of 6 Mach and reached up to 32.5 kilometers in 20 seconds. In terms of applications for the hypersonic technology demonstrator vehicle, there are three uses. One, it can be used for launching cruise missiles. One, it can also be used for launching satellites at a low cost, at a lower altitude, atmospheric altitudes. And third, it can also be used for enhancing the speed of the existing cruise missiles such as BrahMos 1. With BrahMos 1 with a hypersonic speed forms BrahMos 2. Thank you, friends. With this, we covered the current affairs for the month of July. In the next video, we'll be covering the current affairs for the month August. Thank you all. Keep watching the Smart Leaders online video series. Thank you. Be safe and keep working hard.